Welcome. Grab your favorite morning beverage and join us for Morning Cannolis with Jim Santel. You don't know me, but I'm your brother. Sampling the news desserts of the week, here is your host, Jim Santel.
Good morning. This is Morning Cannolis, and it is also Saturday, April 22nd, 2023. Thank you so much for joining me on this wonderful Saturday morning here in the state of Wisconsin. This is, as always, our weekly review, our analysis, our discussion of those most important stories and events in government, in law, and the aspiration for justice in America. We are coming to you this morning from the studios of WAUK in beautiful downtown Waukesha, but we're broadcast throughout stations throughout the state of Wisconsin through Civic Media. And again, delighted to have all of you from throughout the state joining me this morning for 2 hours of discussion of justice in America, law in America, government in America, lots and lots of things to get through this morning. As always, we're taking your call-in questions, your comments, your perspectives this morning. That number is 844-967-2789. Once again, 844-967-2789. My wonderful, highly professional producer, Anya, is always here also to take your calls and to get your comments on the air with me this morning, both in this first hour of Morning Cannolis and then also in the second hour. As always, we've got an ambitious but achievable agenda, a syllabus that hopefully will be informative and inspiring. We also always ask three questions. What happened? What are the events of the week? What are the significant things we need to know about? Second, why is that important? Why should we care? Why is it relevant? Why is it material to our lives? And what should we do, if anything we can do? What actions should we take? What responses are out there? And this morning, pursuant to those three questions that we always ask, we do have that very ambitious, hopefully educational, hopefully inspiring, thought-provoking syllabus for you this morning. After a few minutes talking, as we often do, about what happened today in history, both American history and worldwide history, I'm going to talk about some major, highly important breaking stories in the life and livelihood of our nation. Of course, I'm going to talk again this morning about abortion, privacy rights, and in particular, something major that the United States Supreme Court did just yesterday, late yesterday afternoon, having to do with this drug mifepristone and the consequences of that. We'll chat about how we got there. We'll also talk about what's going to happen in the wake of this very important decision by the Supreme Court, in many ways, not to decide and to send it back to the lower court. We're going to talk also about another major story having to do with the rule of law and justice in America, and that is the settlement early this week in the Dominion voting case against Fox News. We'll talk about the things that, again, led up to that, both in terms of the rulings by the presiding judge, the significance of that settlement, and where things go from here, the cases that are still out there to be adjudicated in the courts of our land. We're going to talk again about Airman Teixeira, that is the young man who compromised, presumably, according to the allegations coming out of the Department of Justice, our national security by posting online information about our relationship with Russia and, in specific, our connection with and our support of Ukraine and its war against Russia. Some interesting news breaking just in that front as well. We'll talk about the process of this past week, a little bit of criminal constitutional procedure, and also, again, talk about what's going to happen down the road. We necessarily need to talk once again about the Supreme Court, not only in connection with its decision yesterday about abortion and about what's going to happen in the future, but also about Clarence Thomas, some additional information about things he disclosed and, most importantly, did not disclose in the past about his expenditures, the things that he was receiving as gifts, his connections with a Texas billionaire, and things that would now be required and also compelling the advocacy is going to be a compelled establishment of a code of ethics for the members of the Supreme Court. We'll talk about that, the reasons for that, the impetus for getting that done, and then reaching into the states of our nation, talking about Tennessee and the expulsion of those two legislators, their return to the legislature, legislature there. And then also because all of that related to firearms in America, we're going to begin in our second hour discussion of that all-important issue, hearkening back to two recent decisions of our Supreme Court that have dramatically impacted our thinking, our understanding, the law of guns, firearms in our nation, and then also talking about the things that can and should be done in Wisconsin and throughout the United States to address what is plainly a crisis. Not only a healthcare crisis, a security crisis, a safety crisis in our nation, talking about the events of just this past week and things that can and should be done, answering that third question that we always ask here on Morning Cannolis. Again, thanking you for joining me this morning, both in our first hour and then our second hour. We're going to be here all morning taking your comments, your questions once again at 844-967-2789. Anya and I here in the studios to take those questions, those perspectives, and those inquiries about things that we're talking about in our ambitious but achievable syllabus this morning. Let's talk first about things that happened on this date, April 22nd, in the history of our world, the history of our nation. Many of this morning, related to the rule of law and justice-related issues. Let's talk first about a significant thing that happened beginning noon, 1889, April 22nd, by federal decree, specifically a thing called the Indian Appropriations Bill that authorized the taking the transfer of lands by those laws. White settlers, for the first time, were allowed into Indian country, into what we now know as Oklahoma, at that time the Oklahoma Territory. This happening, obviously, in the context of the Trail of Tears, our terrible mistreatment of major tribes moved across the southern portion of our nation, ultimately landing in Oklahoma. Today, 1889 at noon, white settlers permitted to go into that Indian country, leading to sparking a land rush involving quite literally tens of thousands of people coming into Oklahoma for that purpose. Significant in many, many ways beyond the time we have this morning to discuss that. We know as well that the Supreme Court not too long ago, a couple of years ago, in an opinion called McGirt, was authored by Neil Gorsuch of the Supreme Court, found that much, if not all, of the what is now known as Oklahoma, at that time the Oklahoma Territory, was in fact and is still in fact an Indian territory, Indian land, by virtue of territorial treaties and other decrees entered into by the United States government with those Native American tribes, sovereign nations in our nation back in the late 19th century. And so today, again, we think about that event, 1889, on this day in history. Another issue related to, once again, international law. It was on today, 1915, in the midst of World War I, that German forces introduced horrifically the systematized use of chemical warfare when the Germans released for the first time some chlorine gas. It was along a four-mile front at the Second Battle of Ypres in Belgium. And it initiated this notion that it was somehow permissible in the midst of war, which is admittedly crisis, tragedy from beginning to end, to impose that kind of warfare upon an enemy combatant. Systemized use of chemical warfare. We know that the rule of law eventually took place and took over, even in the midst of something that is decidedly not justice-related, that is war. Nonetheless, chemical warfare since prohibited, even in the midst of war, not always observed, and we know that plainly there are some leaders of nations who have sometimes used chemical warfare, sometimes on their own people. But again, a rule of law issue back in 1915 during the course of World War I, the first time that chemical weapons were used in the midst of military efforts. That in 1915. 1952, the U.S. broadcast for the first time a live atomic bomb test, Yucca Flat in Nevada. That would happen on television in 1952. Other things, a big event in 1970 on this day was the first Earth Day, which we're going to be observing, of course, this week. All throughout our nation, we should be observing Earth Day, and we'll do that just that. It was first observed on April 22nd, 1970, when about 20 million people around the country, students, young people, middle-aged people, older people, gathered together in communities, schools, colleges, places of common gathering to recognize that this is our Earth and the only Earth that we have. It initiated by virtue of the not only directives, but also the things that were encouraged to be done at that time, a whole focus on ways in which we can do things to preserve our our country, and most importantly, the world in which we live, recognizing that borders of nations do not keep contaminants, environmental challenges from passing over them. Earth Day 1970, on this day, April 22nd. Also on this day, another significant issue in the rule of law happening. Elian Gonzalez, remember that name? Elian Gonzalez, a six-year-old who survived a shipwreck. He and his mother were coming here from Cuba. And his mother was drowned, tragically, along with others, as he was making his way to Florida. He comes here, and he is ultimately in the custody, the control, if you will, of some relatives in Florida. A great, great international dispute that was negotiated by one of my bosses. Had the great honor and privilege to work for Janet Reno, the longest-serving contemporary attorney general in our history. Janet Reno obliged to determine what should happen with Elian Gonzalez by virtue of the fact that matters related to international law and specifically immigration, these kinds of things, within the purview, within the focus of the U.S. Department of Justice. Ultimately, Janet Reno making the decision to return Elian Gonzalez to his father, who wanted him back in Cuba. And she makes that determination. And as a result of that, it was on this day, April 22nd of 2000, 23 years ago, that SWAT team came into the home where Elian Gonzalez was being cared for by his family and took him, returned him ultimately to his father in Cuba. We know and we have seen that Elian Gonzalez has reappeared in the national and international stage. He is now a representative in the government of Cuba and making statements about his role. Obviously, no longer a six-year-old, a young adult pursuing presumably his future and the future of his country there in Cuba. 2000, Elian Gonzalez was on this day returned to his father. Also on this day, 2016, the Paris Agreement on Climate Change, a bookend in many ways to what we are observing tomorrow and the days ahead, Earth Day, this landmark treaty that sought to control and reduce greenhouse gas concentrations in our atmosphere. It took effect in November, but it was signed today, April 22nd of 2016. All those things, all those important things happening on this day in history, April 22nd. Many of them, it is significant how many of them do in fact partake of the rule of law. Speaking of the rule of law and justice, as we come back from this break, going to launch into those major stories we talked about having to do with justice, government, and the rule of law in America. Stay with us for that and much more. We are back here on Morning Cannolis, talking with you this morning, as we do every Saturday morning, about justice, the rule of law in America, and government as well. Let's launch into those major stories, big stories of this past week. Let's begin with a word we have all come to pronounce well, mifepristone. That is the drug that has been much on our minds, much on our tongues, much in the writing of the Supreme Court, as it turns out, just last night. What is the predicate for this? We have chatted about this before. We've talked about this before, and I suspect many of you, if not all of you, already know what the predicates for this are. We have a judge in the Northern District of Texas, a federal judge. His name is Kaczmarek. A couple of weeks ago, he makes a determination that mifepristone, which is commonly used, authorized for a quarter of a century by the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, to be used safely and effectively in abortions and in other reproductive services, also highly important for treatment of miscarriage situations. That drug, safe and secure, according to all the testing, all the reporting, the recording of those tests by the FDA. Judge Kaczmarek takes a look at this upon the petition, upon a civil lawsuit filed there in his court, and says that the authorization given by the FDA some 23 years ago inadequate, improper, and therefore bans the use of mifepristone nationwide, not just in northern Texas, nationwide, finds that that was inappropriately done by the FDA, and so sends the issue of abortion back into not only our national consciousness, but also ultimately ending in the Supreme Court. We'll get to that in just a moment or so. He does stay his opinion for about 7 days because he recognizes that this is controversial, that he is, for the first time in our nation's history, a federal judge who has taken it upon himself to determine what the FDA is properly commissioned and authorized to determine here. That is the medical efficacy and effectiveness of drugs. He decides that the FDA acted improperly, stays that order for about 7 days, and sure enough, the United States Department of Justice, your United States Department of Justice, pursues this where to an appeal to the United States Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit, the immediate court above the district court in the Northern District of Texas, one of the most conservative courts, as we know from our previous discussions in the United States of America. And the Court of Appeals does this. They basically say that mifepristone could remain available, but that access to it would remain restricted according to what Judge Kaczmarek had said, specifically important issues related to access by virtue of the mails, which is one of the principal ways in which mifepristone is distributed across state lines. That aspect of the FDA ruling that permitted that to happen, that was likewise struck down, if you will, by the Fifth Circuit. Also that non-physicians could no longer prescribe this, could no longer give authorization for the use and distribution of the pill. Those things also authorized by the FDA by virtue of its review and its imprimatur upon those processes. So that's where it stands coming out of the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals. The United States Department of Justice not satisfied with that. According to our Attorney General, according to the civil folks at Maine Justice, they appeal. They pursue an emergency appeal to the United States Supreme Court, asking the Supreme Court to overturn what the Fifth Circuit did, to overturn what the lower court, Judge Kaczmarek, did, and return things to the way they have been in this nation for a quarter century. And during the course of this past week, the Supreme Court did a number of different things. The first thing the Supreme Court does is it orders that the parties early this week on Monday and Tuesday submit some briefs, putting this plainly on a fast track for decision. And of course, they do that. The government files its brief, the opposition in favor of what the Fifth Circuit and what the lower court has done. They also file briefs. Those are reviewed by the Supreme Court, anticipating a decision on Wednesday. But on Wednesday of this week, we got another important opinion from the Supreme Court saying that we're going to extend the decision process here. We're going to continue what the Supreme Court had previously said, which is we're staying everything. We're not going to permit anything to go into effect until we've got the opportunity to review all the things in front of us. And they moved the deadline date, if you will, until midnight last night, midnight on Friday, and said we'll issue something by the close of business or certainly by midnight last night when this otherwise established deadline would expire. And sure enough, true to their word, that's exactly what the Supreme Court did. Late yesterday, the Supreme Court said that everything will in fact go back, at least for now, temporarily, to the way it was before these decisions. Basically, that mifepristone remains available, that the access provisions provided by the FDA with respect to mail and also by non-physician prescription, those could remain in place as well. All that gets returned to the way it was before Judge Kaczmarek and his order started all this, but not making a substantive ruling on the merits of the case. Instead, what the Supreme Court says is we're going to send this back to the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, and we'll have them basically play around with this, review this in greater detail, determine what should and should not happen there. And sure enough, by an order of 7-2, seven members of the Supreme Court, two of them dissenting, 7-2. The Supreme Court sends this entire matter, even while it continues to be stayed, anything below, none of that, those decisions that are overturning the precedent, the tradition of 25 years, none of that in place, sends it back to the Fifth Circuit. And on May 17th, not too long from now, the Fifth Circuit is going to have oral argument on the merits of all of this. A three-judge panel will take this up again, presumably briefs that have already been filed, presumably more briefs going to be filed. And on May 17th, attorneys for both sides arguing this case again, not before the Supreme Court, but before the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, determining whether or not, again, once again, mifepristone remains accessible, and if so, under what conditions. Does the FDA have the authority to do this, and under what conditions will that go forward? Significantly, this is a part of what is sometimes called the shadow docket by the Supreme Court, entering an order not premised upon a huge exposition of its facts and of the reasons for doing it. And as we come back right after the break, I'm going to talk with you more about the specifics of the order from the Supreme Court yesterday, sending this back to the Fifth Circuit, an order that does get some attention because of the things that Justice Alito said in dissent, along with Justice Thomas in this case. Stay with us for that discussion here on Morning Cannolis. We are back. Thank you for joining me this morning in our discussion right now at this time of this major decision issued by the United States Supreme Court just within the past 24 hours, basically saying that mifepristone remains available. This abortion pill, this pill used, this pharmaceutical used also in connection with miscarriage treatment remains available pursuant to the FDA approval granted about a quarter century ago, again, safely and securely, medical treatment in our nation. Along the way, the Supreme Court says that we're sending this back to the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, oral argument in a few weeks, May 17th. They can take up the merits of this. It's not over. It's not done. Likely to percolate up once again to the United States Supreme Court. But we know from the order, the summary order issued by the Supreme Court, that this was not a unanimous decision, that there were seven justices in favor of sending this back to the Fifth Circuit for its further adjudication of the merits. Two of the justices dissented. And one of them in particular wrote a bit of an opinion complaining about the fact that the Supreme Court is not, in fact, wrestling with this issue on the merits. His name is Justice Samuel Alito. He happens to also be the justice who, as you well know, wrote this landmark decision that was released in June of last year in Dobbs versus Reproductive Health Services, overturning nearly 50 years of privacy rights in connection with reproductive rights and abortion in America. Justice Alito yesterday writing that he is not happy with his colleagues on the Supreme Court sending this back. And in particular, he does two things in his dissent in his decision, his opinion that this case should not have been sent back. He first suggests along the way that the Biden administration would not have followed a decision of the Supreme Court on its merits, even so. A fascinating thing for a Supreme Court justice to say, plainly, completely hypothetical, completely inappropriate, I would offer, just because it's just this random comment about the Biden administration, suggesting the Biden administration would not follow the rule of law, even if the Supreme Court were to issue an order. So that's one portion of his dissent in this. The other one is taking some criticism, taking some shots, if you will, at his colleagues. And for part of his opinion, he talks about this thing called the shadow docket. Again, not a great word. I'm not a big fan of it. It's basically where the Supreme Court members rule on procedural matters like this, typically not substantive. Cases that are considered on this docket typically do not get the same level of review, the in-depth oral argument, all the briefing of other cases, typically because of the need to act quickly. And the decisions are usually accompanied by little, if no explanation, about why they're doing what they're doing. You don't get a lot of clarity, and thus the word shadow. But it's not done in the shadows. It's just a procedural device to get things moving. So that's what the order was all about yesterday. Along the way, Justice Alito takes this opportunity to focus on this shadow docket concept. He writes that the court had previously been criticized for shadow docket decision-making and specifically calls out calls out three female justices, his colleagues on the Supreme Court, Elena Kagan, Sonia Sotomayor, and Amy Coney Barrett. Again, across the political aisles, the partisan aisles, if you will, liberal and conservative. And he cites rulings at the time about their what he calls their hypocrisy, in which they previously objected to using the shadow docket, but yesterday using it to accomplish this. He defended the court against complaints about the use of this docket in the past and said this. He said, "I do not agree with these criticisms at the time, but if they were warranted in the cases in which they were made, they are emphatically true here." Again, none of this significant in terms of changing the outcome, but significant that Judge Alito, along with Judge Thomas, are dissenting in this decision to send the matter back to the Fifth Circuit, and along the way, not just implicitly, but explicitly, permitting the FDA approval of mifepristone to go forward. And so today, on this morning of April 22nd, 2023, we're back to where we were before Justice Judge Kaczmarek in Northern Texas entered his orders a couple of weeks ago. But more to come, and certain in wake of the oral argument of May 17th, probably at just about the time that the Supreme Court is going to be issuing decisions in many, many other cases, probably in May, in June, we're going to hear again from the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals on the merits, the substantive merits of this case that had sort of a rocket ride from the Northern District to the Fifth Circuit to the Supreme Court, now going back to the Fifth Circuit for further adjudication. Stay tuned as we continue to analyze and talk about all of this. Along the way, we know well that the Supreme Court in recent times, as a part of its legal movement generally, has been focusing on dismantling what's called the administrative state. In recent years, as we've talked in this broadcast, increasingly skeptical the majority has been, not the minority, but the majority been of the power of administrative agencies. And you may recall well that even its last term, the Supreme Court restricted the Environmental Protection Agency in tackling climate change issues, another issue coming up this term as well under the Clean Water Act. So we'll be visiting that again. Also prohibiting the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, its power to limit the spread of the coronavirus and the president's executive power to do things to keep us safe and secure in the workplace, to keep us healthy in that setting. So a huge focus on the administrative state. Why is that relevant here? Well, plainly, we've got another agency here, the FDA, also making decisions, important decisions about our lives, our livelihood, about the medicines to which we can and should have access. All of that, a part of the Supreme Court's review of these cases. Highly likely, the Supreme Court, even though it felt at the time of Dobbs last year that this is not a matter that should be in the courts, but should be in the legislatures for the people to decide through their legislative representatives, it's coming back. And the Supreme Court certainly is going to be hearing this matter likely once again, once the Fifth Circuit decides the case. Whoever wins, whoever loses, likely to appeal this yet again to the Supreme Court. The case, the contest, the challenge goes on in America. Speaking of challenges, let's turn to one of the other major news stories of this past week. Challenges in court, this time in the Delaware Superior Court. This is a state court, not a federal court, but a Delaware Superior Court. And in particular, a case presided over by a gentleman named Eric Davis, Judge Eric Davis. What is the case? You know it well. It's Dominion voting machines versus Fox News. Dominion voting machines versus Fox News. What is the basis for this lawsuit? A couple of years ago, Dominion voting machines files this civil lawsuit again, not a criminal lawsuit, a civil lawsuit seeking defamation damages from Fox News. And how does that come about? They allege, Dominion voting machines, that by virtue of things said, by the on-air so-called talent, by the anchors, by the people on Fox News who are daily and every evening coming into your homes, coming into your workplaces, espousing a couple of things. One is that the 2020 election was stolen. The big lie is, in fact, not a big lie, that indeed Joe Biden did not win the election, espousing all of that plainly untrue fact about the 2020 election, that the election was stolen by virtue of fraud, other things happening during the course of polling. All of that, of course, not true, proven by every single court that looked at this in the wake of the 2020 election, known to be a lie coming out of the mouths and the earpieces of the anchors of Fox News. Dominion voting machines brought into this, because Fox News is also saying that the Dominion voting machines are one of the mechanisms through which this fraud was accomplished. Dominion voting machines has this mechanism, according to Fox News, by virtue of which a vote for Donald Trump was changed to a vote for Joe Biden. And this happened with sufficient frequency that the vote was therefore skewed, and we've got the wrong president in the White House. Completely untrue, completely false. And Dominion voting machines comes back and says, you know, we're not going to take that. They file a lawsuit in the Delaware court, and they allege that Fox News, by virtue of these very public things stated about the Dominion voting machines and their entity, their provision of these highly reliable and integrity-filled machines, that those statements that suggest that they're not, in fact, either one of those things are defamatory, that Fox News has defamed Dominion voting machines. And they seek $1.6 billion in damages. Why? Because according to Dominion, the statements by Fox News caused them to lose business, caused them to have compromises in their reputation. Makes some sense, right? What happens is during the course of the next 2 years, discovery, pretrial discovery, before this goes to trial, lots of information exchanged, people deposed, including the on-air talent at Fox News, Rupert Murdoch deposed, who is the owner and operator of Fox News as well. All kinds of information exchanged between the parties in anticipation of what? The start of the trial, which was in fact begun just barely this past week in the courtroom presided over by Judge Eric Davis. And prior to the start of that proceeding this past week, Judge Davis does three things that change dramatically what happened this past week. He says, first of all, I'm finding as a matter of law, as a matter of fact, that all these things that Fox News said on the air during the course of the number of years in which they've been broadcasting, all these things about the big lie, all these things about the 2020 election being stolen, and that Dominion voting machines were in part the reason for the defrauding of that vote, all that's not true. And Judge Eric Davis says, I'm going to tell the jury as a matter of law and as a matter of fact, they don't need to wrestle with that issue. It is a matter of fact that I am instructing them that the statements made by Fox News were false. None of that was true, and they're going to hear that from me. I'm making that finding as a matter of my judicial oversight of this case. What he does say is, I'm going to let the jury decide a second issue. And the second issue that I'm going to let them decide is whether or not those statements were articulated, were conveyed by that on-air talent with what's called malicious intent. Malicious intent. Did they intend to do it? Did they knowingly say things on the air that were false? The statements were false. Did they do that with the intent of malice, with the intent to misrepresent, knowing what they were doing? And that's the question that Judge Davis says, I will leave for the jury to decide. Well, with respect to that, we also know that during the course of discovery, huge numbers of statements made internal to Fox News, between the anchors, among them staff leaders, news directors, saying that they recognize behind the scenes that all those things they're saying on air are not true. Admissions behind the scenes in emails, in texts, that they know that the position being taken by the now former president that the election was stolen, completely false, and even make some scurrilous comments about the people who articulate that view, acknowledging along the way that what they're saying on the air is completely contrary to what they know to be true. That is very compelling evidence of exactly that second issue that Judge Davis was going to send to the jury, which is, well, was this done with malicious intent, with the intent, basically, to defraud the American populace tuning into Fox News? And so that portion of the discovery, highly relevant to the case. Judge Davis does a couple of other things that are also important to understanding the case. Number one, he says that I'm going to prevent Fox News from defending this case by saying this. Fox News purporting to argue before the jury that what they were doing was simply reporting on what other people were saying, that they themselves were not saying these things. These were not their own creations, but things that other people were saying, including Donald Trump and Rudy Giuliani and Sidney Powell and other people out there articulating this big lie. They were simply reporting on that. And Judge Davis also said, you know what? I'm not going to permit you to argue that before the jury. If you try it, I'm going to shut you down. Do not argue that sort of derivative use argument. You still repeated those statements. You're responsible for the statements. And so he shuts down that defense as well. And finally, a third thing happens. All this before the trial begins. The judge also reviews a major, more than foot fault, but a huge, huge problem among the attorneys for Fox News. Specifically, during the course of the last days, right before the trial, Fox News produces some additional discovery related to these things that are also being said behind the scenes, and also reveals for the first time after 2 years of discovery, that Rupert Murdoch had a much greater role to play with respect to the news and the administration of the on-air presentations. Those revelations made right before the trial begins, and the judge also expresses great concern about that, says, I'm going to sanction you for that late discovery disclosure. I may appoint someone to investigate this, and because of that, I am going to impose sanctions against you. In the wake of all that, the big news of this past week, which we will talk about right after this break, the result of all those rulings, all those 2 years of discovery exchanges, culminating in a major event on Tuesday of this past week. Stay with us as we discuss this major piece of litigation settled this past week in the Delaware State Court. We are back for our final segment of just this first hour, our two-hour program this morning, and we're talking about Fox News and about this major lawsuit brought by Dominion Voting Machines against Fox News for defamation, a case that resulted in a not entirely surprising, but certainly sudden result this past week. Right before the break, talking with you about these major decisions made by the presiding judge to shut down Fox News in connection with many of its arguments about the manner in which its on-air talent behaved in perpetrating this fraud, these lies about the 2020 election, indicating as well that their own lawyers were in some trouble with the court. Never a good thing right before trial to be in trouble with the court. The judge finding that they had also engaged in discovery violations, sanctioning them and telling them they're in trouble even as we're going to trial. So what happens? All of this going ahead while these behind-the-scenes rulings are being made. And over the weekend, the judge, Eric Davis, says, you know what, I'm going to take a one-day hiatus. And so on Monday, contrary to the previous schedule, nothing happens in court, leading an awful lot of people to think, well, gee, maybe something is in fact going on here in the wake of these significant decisions by Judge Eric Davis, pretty much shutting down, recognizing that this case is going to trial. Maybe it is finally dawning on Fox News that this is real and that indeed they're going to trial. And one of the things that probably animated a lot of what happened on Monday and then into Tuesday was just this. Undeniably, during the course of the trial, many of those people, that on-air talent, people like Laura Ingraham and Tucker Carlson, Sean Hannity, likely even Rupert Murdoch himself, the owner-operator, taking the stand, and whether on direct or cross-examination, almost certainly being confronted not only with their hypocrisy, the things they say on air being completely contrary to what they say behind the scenes, acknowledging privately amongst themselves to each other and to their news staff supervisors that the things they're saying on air are false, are not true about the 2020 election. They would certainly be confronted on the stand not only with those misstatements on air, but probably required to say in the end, to acknowledge under oath that what they have done, what they have said over the course of these many years on air has been a lie. The things that they have said are not true, and the representations said to their viewers about the 2020 election being stolen, including the fact that Dominion voting machines were somehow responsible for that, all of that was made up. None of that true, and they knew it. And probably the prospect of Fox News having its on-air talent being in a public domain, testifying under oath to that hypocrisy was too much. And so what happens sometime on Monday, almost certainly, is Fox News, after not having engaged in much settlement, as far as we know, with Dominion voting machines, not much discussion there, approaches Dominion voting machines and says, what can we do to settle this case? And indeed, we don't know. We don't know exactly how this played out, but we do know what happened on Tuesday morning in the wake of these bad rulings for Fox News by the judge, and also this prospect that their own talent, their own very much visible personalities will be on the stand having to admit that what they've said to the American people as journalists, knowingly lying to America, that coming up. The result Tuesday morning is that the jury, believe it or not, is impaneled. A jury is set to go. They're ready to hear all this testimony. Indeed, the parties are ready to present their opening statements, an opening statement from Dominion going forward. It's the plaintiff has got the burden of proof. An opening statement from Fox News also in the wings, waiting to happen. And right before that happens, there's another pause, and everyone is wondering what's going on here. And ultimately, the judge comes out and says, members of the jury, we thank you very much for the service you provided, but in fact, we don't need your service because the parties have settled this case. We've taken care of this additional issue with respect to the findings I would otherwise ask you to make. And indeed, the parties have settled. They disposed of this case. They've resolved it, absent the need for going ahead. And we know because of in the wake of that, the attorneys for Dominion voting machines came out and said that Fox News had agreed to pay nearly $800 million, $787.5 million in money damages to Dominion voting machines to settle the case. A huge, whopping amount of money, nearly $800 million, about half of what they had requested initially, somehow cut that number down to that. And plainly, there's a basis for that. We don't know quite yet where exactly that specific number comes from, but presumably based upon something related to Dominion voting machines, the defamation of it, and the damages it suffered as a result of these statements by Fox News and its on-air anchors. That announced, again, right after the case is resolved in the Delaware Circuit Court. A couple of things in the wake of all of that. Of course, not completely a surprise after the hiatus of Monday, but certainly a surprise after 2 years of very vigorous litigation. Not a surprise given what likely would have happened in the course of the trial, probably a several-week trial. And in fact, we're not done. We know that there is other lawsuits out there. We know there are other folks out there who are waiting in the wings also. Same kind of allegations, defamation charges. We know that Smartmatic, which is this software company, also alleging defamation by Fox News, Smartmatic providing the software. The allegation that Fox News out there is saying that Smartmatic also responsible because of the nature of its software for the undermining of the 2020 election. Same kind of allegations made by Fox News. Smartmatic turns around and they also have sued Fox News to the tune of $2.7 billion. That case going to trial probably in a couple of years, no time soon. That is out there as well. Presumably other matters up for resolution, even in the wake of this Fox News case. Now, why is all this important? Why is it significant to spend this much time on it? Well, first of all, it goes to the integrity of one of what is admittedly one of our major, arguably, news sources in America. And this is the kind of thing that every American, regardless of where you are in the political spectrum, what your partisan views, your political views may be, should understand clearly that Fox News, and we knew this before because of the discovery releases, Fox News has paid nearly $800 million to settle a lawsuit in which it allegedly defamed the Dominion voting machines. That is, for all intents and purposes, acknowledgement of responsibility for the things that they said on air. And if nothing more, the American population, again, Republicans, Democrats, people in the middle of the road, should understand the importance of Fox News' position now. A clear revelation in the wake of the discovery, in the wake of the settlement of this case, that Fox News acted contrary to what we anticipate journalists will do, which is convey the news accurately and forthrightly. That's a part of the message coming out of this very important case, a First Amendment case to be sure, but one that should resonate today and beyond for a long period of time in the history of our nation, understanding what responsibility news organizations have and the things that happen when, as here, they do not live up to that great responsibility they have under the First Amendment of our Constitution. Come back for our second hour. We're going to talk more about major issues, including the Supreme Court and other matters before our national attention. Stay with us for that and join us for that discussion as well. We are back for this, our second hour here on Morning Cannolis, our weekly examination, our analysis, our discussion of the major news stories in law and government and the aspiration for justice in America. Always interested in your comments, your calls, your questions. And indeed, we're going to start this second hour with comments and questions, maybe some calls as well from you. We'll begin with Joe from Madison, who is calling in. Joe, glad to have you with me once again this Saturday morning.
Thank you for all the information about the Dominion suit. That's really, really important. And the detail that you brought to the discussion is very helpful to understand where things were. I wanted to just, this is kind of a broad thing, but I hope it will bear fruit when looking at this Dominion case and also looking at the situation of the Supreme Court and Judge Thomas's hijinks, might be a nice way of saying it. This week in news, the NFL released information that they had from an investigation that they had on players betting that there were, I think, five or six Detroit Lions players who were investigated and found to have been betting, which the NFL does not allow, not even if it's not your games. You aren't allowed to bet on any NFL games or the draft. You're just not allowed to do that. So it started with the Detroit Lions players. It's gone to staff. And it also includes now players, I guess, from the Washington Commanders. And I think one of the things that's interesting about this is that it's very important to the NFL, apparently, to route out and find out if people are cheating, betting on games or somehow affecting any of the outcome of how things go. And this business is really big on it has to look fair. If players are betting on games, out they go. So I throw that into the mix because then we look at Judge Thomas, one of nine lifetime appointments, who says about the shenanigans he was engaged with, quote, "I didn't know it was wrong." That was one of the things he said. And quote, I'm not going to do it anymore. That's going to be his excuse. And so far, I know that there have been some within the Senate that have been looking to try to shake this down a little bit. But I guess I'm sort of appalled that Roberts, the person who is oversees the Supreme Court and the history and the look of it, has not come down like a pail of bricks on this person for making this court look like it's cheating. I mean, and then we have, the situation with Fox News and the Dominion lawsuit, where obviously they were cheating. I mean, it was so apparent that you said that the judge overseeing this case said the jury doesn't even have to decide whether they were lying or not. That was apparent. It was just whether they did it with malice or not. That's all that they were trying to find out. So we're stuck with these two things, and I think they're important to look at is, number one, what do we call it when you have such rank corruption in the Supreme Court, and when we have the situation where an entity calls itself Fox News, when any news organization will tell you if they get something wrong, if it is wrong, absolutely, you go to your corrections, go on air, and you say, we got it wrong, here's why, and here's why we're going to attend to it. And I guess one of the other, so I'd like to talk about that because I don't think we should call it Fox News anymore. It's not a news organization. News organizations correct it when it's wrong. And there have been no on-air, mea culpas, we did it wrong and we're going to do a better job into the future. In the same way, I'm curious about the idea that we speak of damages and it's damages for Dominion Voting Company, which obviously very clearly is damage. But I would argue that all of us have been damaged by absolutely a national news organization, right, that lied to us and to the point of affecting our election. And so I'm curious about, what kind of recourse is there for an individual citizen or a group of citizens, League of Women Voters, whatever, to come to the courts to say, We were damaged by what Fox News did. I'm interested in your speculation on this, and I frame it with, let's look at what the NFL did to root out corruption in their ranks, and then look at what Fox News did and the Supreme Court. I don't see much. It seems like they need the NFL offering some standards. Right. So thanks, Jim. I appreciate your thoughts on this.
Great, Joe. Thanks. You a lot to unpack there, but all to a very important point about integrity in our systems, right? And especially that point that you made about the damages we all suffer. Courts, of course, focus upon parties and the specific things here that Dominion voting machines suffered. But you're absolutely right, especially in a situation where you've got broadcast airwaves, and this is going out to quite literally tens of millions of people consuming it and believing it. What is the impact not only on them, but again, more broadly, upon our national discourse, our national status? Huge numbers of people today continuing to believe that the 2020 election was stolen, in major part because of the daily infusion of that lie into our national discourse, our national discussion. And it is difficult to capture that, of course. But this all goes to, if you want to get legal about this once again, the issue of standing, coming forth and saying that I have been damaged in a way that is cognizable, that I can come forward and say that for this reason, based upon what the defendant has done, I have suffered in some cognizable way. It is going to be difficult, admittedly, to put a dollar figure or even any kind of calculus to that broader focus on what it is that Fox News did to us as a nation and continues to do to this day. By the way, agree entirely. In the wake of this, the notion, even before this, the notion that this is a news operation, plainly a misnomer of the highest level. The one aspect of this that you've heard me rail against in the past or advocate for perhaps more positively is just this, that this kind of thing, and the reason why I'm spending so much time on that this morning, as have others, is that our recourse perhaps come in shouting this from the rooftops, from talking not only to your family members who continue to subscribe to the things that Fox News says on a regular basis, that the importance of the result here, $800 million, the disclosures, the items, the decisions made by the judge here, all of that, it is not difficult to understand. The message is clear, and we need to work more strongly to send the clarity, not in partisan motivation, not by political animation, but to all Americans that this horrific thing happened, and it compromised us as our nation, and this is not the exposition of the First Amendment. To sort of codify, Joe, your very important point, the First Amendment, thus our defamation law, does not permit you to lie. That is a fundamental notion. That instruction, and then also somehow the sense that there needs to be more than just this. There needs to be more than simply damages, monetary damages going to the particular plaintiff here. But America needs to understand that it too was damaged. We continue to work on that by talking more about this and, again, doing things to ensure that people understand that what happened on Tuesday, announced this past week, is no small thing, and that it should prompt people to, you know what, to turn off Fox News. If you've lied about this significant thing, what else are you lying about as well? And should discredit not only Rupert Murdoch and his new organization, but those people who perpetrated these lies on air. Very significant points. Joe, a lot. We'll talk about Clarence Thomas later on in this hour as well. We've got other callers on the line, which we're delighted to take as well. Let's talk first with Gary from Sussex. Gary, thanks for your call in this morning.
Okay. Jim, I've called in to talk to you. I've listened to you many times in the devil's advocate and everything. I'm not trying to trap you. I'm going to ask you a couple questions. I just want to know what your opinion is.
Sure.
Because everything that I give is my opinion and how I look at it. And your listeners can understand how conservative looks at things.
Sure.
All right. Now, as far as, let's go back to the shooting in Tennessee. The legislators go in there and they start marching around and causing all sorts of chaos and problems. Now, let me ask you, there's supposed to be a semblance of dignity and calmness when you go into the Capitol, and same thing when you go into court. So let's say if you're going to be going into a trial and you don't like how the judge is handling things. Now, Jim, what would happen to you if you got a bullhorn and got in the judge's face and started yelling and screaming at him and say, I don't like this, and then getting all the people that were sitting there listening to you, agreeing with you, and then starting to stomp their feet and yelling. What would happen to you?
Gary, it's a great question. Thanks for the call. I know you. I suspect you have one of the things I would love to engage you in this conversation. Let's do that. Let's talk about Tennessee for a moment because it is on my agenda as well. So what we have here, you've got Justin Jones, Justin Pearson, Gloria Johnson, these three legislators who led these very vocal, very raucous, you're absolutely right, Gary, protests in the well of the Tennessee legislation. Legislature in the wake of the three killings of the three children and the killings of three children and the adults in Nashville, another horrific event in America. And so, again, your question goes to issues of rule of law. Why? Because we can all acknowledge, and we do acknowledge, Gary, you and I agree, as I suspect everyone does, disruptive what they did. Absolutely. This very, very vocal invocation, not just of their position, but shouting it. And the question is, what is the appropriate response, right? Plainly, if I go into court, as you just indicated, and I were to do that sort of thing, there are rules for the court and there are rules for the legislature as well. So my approach on this and my response to what happened is that the response of the legislature to expel them when you've got other remedies was not the appropriate remedy in this situation. You can censure them. You can do other things, as you can do in the Wisconsin legislature here. You can make findings, in fact. You can reprimand them. You can do other things with respect to their specific involvement in things on the floor, in other committees, those kinds of things. You can respond to what can appropriately be viewed as disruptive behavior, even in the midst of their protest. The objection that I have, and I think that many people have, to what happened in Tennessee was the nature of the response, expulsion. Throwing them out when, in fact, there are lower remedies that could, in fact, have been applied here and things that could have been pursued by those legislators. By doing that, they effectively, for the brief period of time that Jones and Pearson and the two of them were out of office, they were not representing their constituents. Now, they're back in office by virtue of the reinstatement votes from the county commissioners, the Metropolitan Council. They came back. They've got to stand for re-election at some point down the road. But as in all things, my approach to this is balance. And yes, indeed, if I were in court and do that, would I get sanctioned by the judge? You bet I would. Absolutely. It's appropriate to respond in kind to the kind of behavior. I probably would not get my license revoked in that moment. The judge could not do that. But it would be appropriate for her or him to impose some kind of sanction on me. The question is whether this particular sanction was the kind that was appropriate. But Gary, appreciate very much the thought. Always interested in views of a great variety. I'm going to go on in our last minute here in this segment to another caller. Mark, you're calling in also this morning. Glad to have you with us. Mark, are you there with us from Prairie du Sac? Mark, are you with us this morning?
I'm here.
All right, Mark, go ahead. We've got just a couple of seconds here. I'll take your question, and then we'll answer it perhaps right on the other side.
Yeah, I did disagree with Gary and so because raucous behavior in chambers like that is nothing out of line. That you're right in terms of it was excessive in terms of punishment. That and for the getting to the Supreme Court. These constructionists on the Supreme Court.
All right, Mark, you know what I'm going to do? Hold that thought. I'm going to take your comment right after the break. Stay with me, and we'll talk more right after this break. And we're back. We're taking some wonderful callers of all political varieties here this morning. Appreciate all of that balance and good discussion right before the break. Mark, talking with you, Mark, about your response to what happened in Tennessee, the expulsion, and then the return of these legislators, Justin Jones and Justin Pearson, also joined by Gloria Johnson, although she was not expelled, out of the Tennessee legislature. And right before the break, Mark, you were articulating your opposing view to what Gary had said about what was happening there in Tennessee. Why don't you go ahead and give me your full thought?
It was excessive, and that, as you have said, and there's another legislator that urinated on another legislator's seat, and he was not expelled. So it just gives support to the fact that what you said was that it was excessive is correct. But getting back to the Supreme Court, and unfortunately I don't have my copy of the Federalist Papers with me right now, but I know that in the Article 3 of the Constitution, It does not say that the Supreme Court justices have a lifetime appointment. It's simply on based on good behavior. Well, in terms of when they're behaving correctly, exhibiting good behavior, and of course, Clarence Thomas has not. I mean, it's also not enumerated in the Constitution. The Supreme Court decides the constitutionality of laws, as pointed out by Hamilton, I think Federalist 75. So I would challenge, why is it that a citizen who is not completely versed in the law can find these falsehoods that to point out to the Supreme Court, that they maintain that they can decide this stuff, and they're supposedly strict constructionists. Well, if they're strict constructionists, they would actually adhere to what exactly the Constitution says rather than what they want it to say. Right.
Lots of good things there also to unpack, Mark. A couple of things again in our discussion, as always, of civics in the morning. You're absolutely right. Lots of those things not in the Constitution. It was a Supreme Court Chief Justice named John Marshall in a case way back in 1803 that said, we are the department, the Justice Department is the one that, the courts in America are the ones who decide the law. It was a statement in a case called Marbury versus Madison. Also, as you indicated, finds its way into the Federalist Papers, but that is the tradition that has followed since that time. And with respect to the issue of good behavior, that is the way that is described in the Constitution, always interpreted throughout 240 years of our history to mean lifetime tenure. And again, can be revisited at some point down the road. But that is the reason why our federal judges, including those in Texas and the Fifth Circuit and on the Supreme Court as well, have lifetime tenure because of the way that that language has been interpreted. We are, in fact, going to get back to Clarence Thomas in just a moment or so as we talk through these issues related to the broader things, I think, Mark, that you had identified here, which goes to integrity once again and the ways in which our Supreme Court justices behave, and these specific revelations about Clarence Thomas, his acceptance of gifts, his connections with this Harlan Crow, this real estate billionaire, and the disclosures not made by him that go to the integrity of the Supreme Court itself. Before we get to that, I'm going to take a couple more callers in this segment and then go back to some of those core issues as well. Gene, you've been on the line for a while here. Gene, calling in from Eau Claire, glad to have you with us again this morning. Go ahead.
Great show, never miss it, and I hope everybody's listening because we learn a lot. I would like to bring up an issue real quick related to problems that we've had in our state, and do we have any remedies with Fox because of the big Gableman fraud? I'm sorry, I call it a fraud. I shouldn't be making judgments, but the millions of dollars spent in the investigation based on lies by Fox that we still continue to pay for. I don't know. Do we have standing in something like that? I mean, to me, either it's a huge conspiracy to overthrow our election involving Republicans, Fox News, and others to spread the big lie, or we all have some damages coming, for them basing their investigation on the news from Fox. I don't know. I'm just wondering, just running it by you. Thank you. I'll hang up. Thank you.
Sure, Gene. Always a good question and comment from you. And that is the thing we wrestle with, right? In the wake of what happened, what we now know about Fox News, this knowing statement on the air that they're misstating knowingly what happened in 2020. What are the long-term consequences of that? And how does that impact Wisconsin, premised in many ways, this investigation by former Justice Gableman into the fraud, the theft reportedly here in Wisconsin, again, premised upon false information. What do we do in terms of damages? Well, we know that there are huge amounts of monies paid for that investigation. Again, as I always have said, this is the time that you petition your elected representatives to remedy that. To try to recover that. And yes, you can go into court. You do, as you indicated, Gene, have to identify some specific basis upon which you have been damaged. You can make the argument. And that's why judges and lawyers are active in these kinds of things, making determinations about whether or not you do have standing. The important thing, as I've said, is continued discussion about these kinds of things and advocacy in those venues where you can, in fact, get some remedies. The legislature is one of them. Courts may well be one of them as well. We're not done, plainly, with this notion that the First Amendment has been abused, I would say, in many ways, by virtue of the kinds of things that Fox News has done. Great comments for thought and for future action as well. I'm going to take at least one more caller here in this segment. Jake, you're calling in this morning as well. Glad to have you with us this morning.
Yeah, I would like to respond to the Republican caller from earlier, Tennessee Gary, who I'm sure is a big fan of Republican Lieutenant Governor of Tennessee, Randy McNally, who's infamous for trolling for young men online. It's really shocking to me that somebody would actually take the position of supporting those neo-Confederate racists in Tennessee who, you know, took out the ultimate punishment there in the legislature on two young black men for speaking their minds. And the First Amendment, yeah, it is guaranteed to everyone in the United States, regardless of your skin color. And also consider the story from 2 days ago, okay? And if I can, I'll just read a couple of the opening paragraphs.
All right, and Jake, I've just got a few seconds left, so if you can be brief about that, that would be great.
Yes, I will. A member of GOP leadership in the Tennessee House of Representatives was recently found guilty of sexually harassing at least one legislative intern, likely two, by an ethics subcommittee acting in secret, News Channel 5 investigates learned. About 6 hours after being confronted by News Channel 5 investigates, Representative Scotty Campbell gave up his seat in the Tennessee General Assembly. Right, until now, right. Campbell, who served as vice chair of the House Republican Caucus, and who recently voted to expel three Democrats who engaged in a gun violence protest on the House floor, had suffered no previous consequences.
Right. And Jake, I'm going to have to bring our conversation right now to an end. We're going to take that up right after the break. Stay with me on that, and we'll continue that conversation. We are back here on Morning Cannolis. Thank you again for joining me this morning as we talk about a number of issues. A lot of them related to integrity in our systems. Appreciate so much all the callers this morning. Right before the break, I was chatting with Jake, who was calling in from California, to identify this additional more than footnotes to the Tennessee story, specifically that a senior legislator there who had previously voted to expel Representatives Justin Jones and Justin Pearson, the legislator named Scotty Campbell. He was found to have violated the legislature's discrimination and harassment policy after complaints against him were filed by two interns to an ethics committee there. Ultimately, he resigns from the legislature. And I think Jake's point was that we've got, again, some hypocrisy here and certainly some inconsistency in terms of the ways in which things are being managed there inside the legislature. Always want to bring to these kinds of things some balance. Again, appropriately calling to the attention of all of us when rules are broken and ensuring that whatever the response to that is, it is commensurate with the nature of the rules that are, in fact, broken. I would offer to you that the First Amendment advocacy, raucous and disruptive, absolutely, by Representatives Jones and Pearson, did not warrant their dismissal, their expulsion, perhaps some kind of sanction, and plainly, much less significant in the broad scope of things than the kind of thing that we now learn with respect to Representative Campbell. He has resigned, he has left, but no sanctions imposed upon him prior to his resignation. Concern about consistency there as well. I think Jake was making that very important point, once again, about the rule of law in all aspects of our lives. Appreciate all of those very good callers. Appreciate also Kevin calling in this morning. Kevin, your thought or comment about our subject matters this morning.
Hello.
Yes, Kevin, glad to have you with me this morning.
Yes. How long has Clarence Thomas been at the Supreme Court?
So you may recall well that George Bush, the father, was the H.W. Bush, appointed him to the United States Supreme Court. You may recall this fairly raucous time, his confirmation hearing, when Anita Hill came forward and alleged that he engaged in sexual harassment. Prior to that, Clarence Thomas was the head of the National Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, and then was elevated by President Bush, George Bush, to the Supreme Court at that time. Huge amount of controversy at that time. He did survive those hearings and has been on ever since that time.
So why do you suspect these allegations are coming out now?
Well, they're unrelated to that particular issue, and so we can chat about those. I appreciate the introduction there. What's happening now, of course, is unrelated to those previous allegations of sexual harassment. This is about disclosures of gifts he has received, other things that implicate ethics issues. In particular, in the last couple of weeks, through some reporting by Politico, disclosures about some week-long retreats in the Adirondacks that he had taken with Harlan Crow, some vacations in East Texas, so a lavish trip to Indonesia, about $500,000 in amount altogether, a number of other things out there, all supported by Harlan Crow, this real estate billionaire. And again, without parsing through all of this, much of that, some of that, not disclosed as the Supreme Court is required to do as a part of their routine disclosures. Why is that important? It's important because of transparency generally. And more importantly, it goes to questions of ethics. Again, you want to make certain that whenever you are in a position of public authority and responsibility, everyone knows about your financial holdings, your relationships. So especially when it comes to Supreme Court justices, you do not have them making decisions that would suggest that they are influenced in any way by friendships, by financial interests, by associations that you have with other companies, other entities out there. It all has to do with transparency. The more important thing I would offer, in addition to these things that are coming out now about the Justice Thomas's receipts of various things, gifts, so forth. And by the way, they continue. He failed to report about $686,000 in income that his wife earned from the Heritage Foundation and some other sources out there. And that leads me to the other issue, which is also a part of the Clarence Thomas analysis these days. This is all about financial things, gifts he's received, his failure to disclose some of these receipts of monies he was getting while he was and is still on the United States Supreme Court. All these revelations coming out. He is amending, to his credit, many of these reports so that they are now a part of the general public information about his sources of income, the things he has gotten. But he should have done that before, and he has acknowledged some of that, although he has not spoken generally about this. More significantly, and the reason I raised the one about his wife, Jenny Thomas, is that issue. And this goes back not only to present times, but recently past events. And that is that Jenny Thomas has also been a very strong advocate for the position that the 2020 election was in fact stolen. And as a result of that, she has been out there advocating for the overturning of the election, and she has a right to do that. That's the First Amendment as well. The concern about Jenny Thomas, not only with respect to this particular financial piece that I just identified, but also generally about the involvement of the Associate Justice on the Supreme Court, is just this: that Clarence Thomas has also been making decisions about things related to January 6th and about the election. Without going into great detail, made decisions about whether or not subpoenas should be enforced, whether or not people should be compelled to testify, whether documents should be produced. All of those matters in the connection with investigations of January 6th, whether or not there should be criminal penalties pursued, investigations pursued. Clarence Thomas was involved in making decisions on the conduct of those investigations, while his spouse was also advocating for matters in that same topic area. She was advocating again that the election was in fact stolen. And the issue is recusal. Under those circumstances where you are partnered with your spouse, your husband, your wife, is involved in the very issues that you are deciding as well on the bench, what judges are obliged to do under the rules of conduct applicable to federal judges at the lower courts is to recuse themselves. So you know what? With respect to this particular issue, because my wife is involved in these same kinds of advocacies, I will not be deciding on whether or not a subpoena should be enforced to pursue an investigation of that very same issue. And he didn't do that. And even though he voted, he was in the minority at the time, did not, his voice was not the one that carried the Supreme Court, to its credit, did enforce those subpoenas, did compel the production of information, did require that disclosures be made, for example, of various things for the purposes of that investigation. He was not in the majority. Nonetheless, the concern about the ethics of a Supreme Court justice making those decisions while his spouse is involved in the same kinds of things. It has to do, again, with transparency, has to do with ethics, And this notion that we expect our justices, our judges generally, whether they are federal or state, to have not only the appearance of impropriety, but no impropriety at all. And that's the reason why there's a huge amount of focus to the point that Joe, our earlier caller, made, and this is where I'm going to go with this. What do we do about all this? What do we, whether it's the specific disclosures about his finances, things coming in, reports he did not make about reimbursements for teaching. He was among the top gift receivers, 1998 to the 2003, $42,000 in gifts that he had not previously disclosed. All those kinds of things are relevant. The question is, what do we do about all that, as Joe had asked, and I think as Jake was also, others, callers were also asking as well. The answer is there needs to be an omnibus across the board imposition of an ethics code for our Supreme Court justices. And what are we doing about that right now? Well, we know from the statements made by justices like Elena Kagan, like the Chief Justice as well, that he has said that they're working on such a code. And to the point that a previous caller made, yes, in the meantime, the Chief Justice needs to be patrolling, if you will, needs to be making not just recommendations, but encouraging strongly not only the proper disclosures by Supreme Court justices, but compelling them to make these disclosures as a part of their basic duties and responsibilities. That code, wherever that comes from, has got to be established, has got to be created very soon, and to ensure that the justices are not engaged in this kind of thing that, unfortunately, Justice Thomas has demonstrated, not only with respect to finances, but also, I would offer more importantly, his own spouse. And so those things are out there. We know as well, again, in the context of what is going on out there, that the Congress is also looking at that. We've spoken in the past about the fact that both houses of Congress, the United States Senate and the House of Representatives, both of them have pieces of legislation pending right now to establish codes of ethics that require recusals in these cases of the sort that the Ginny Thomas, Clarence Thomas situation reflects, requiring that disclosures be made about finances, income sources, gifts being made, requires basically that integrity be returned to the Supreme Court so that all of us have the assurance that when decisions are made, they're not prompted by improprieties, they're not prompted by connections, financial, familial, that justices may have, and that they are in fact prompted and they do in fact recuse themselves when they have those conflicts of interest. That's going on right now in the Congress, and plainly an awful lot of people saying, well, gee, the United States Supreme Court should impose it upon itself before the legislature is required to do that. There is an argument to be made there, but if the Supreme Court doesn't do it itself, an awful lot of people say that the legislature has got to do it. And the final point I'll make about that is Senator Dick Durbin, who is the chair right now of the Senate Judiciary Committee with responsibility of these kinds of things. Dick Durbin has indicated that he has invited the Chief Justice, John Roberts, to appear before him in one of these upcoming hearings coming up in early May, to talk about a number of different things. Presumably high on that list will be this issue of ethics for all of the members of the Supreme Court, not just Clarence Thomas, not just involving his spouse, not just involving finances and income and other gifts being given to you by private individuals, but generally the establishment, the creation of this code of conduct that all of the Supreme Court justices will follow in the future. We'll see whether or not the Chief Justice takes up the senator's invitation and comes to that meeting, that hearing, to discuss these all-important issues. This is the kind of thing that all Americans should be concerned about because of what we've talked about in this program. Huge numbers of incredibly important issues being decided by our Supreme Court. June is going to be a very significant month once again in the history of our nation, as they decide on everything from environmental issues and financial issues and voting rights issues and all kinds of things out there that we've discussed before. We need to ensure that Americans know that our justices, when they make those judgment calls, whatever they decide, are not the products of some inappropriate involvement with other people, with interests that are not publicly known, and their decisions, rather, are premised simply upon the law and the facts. And that's the point. And that's the point about this discussion about Justice Thomas and the other justices on the Supreme Court. We've got a couple of other callers here in our last couple of minutes in this segment. Ken, you're calling in from Sturgeon Bay. Let's hear from you as well. Glad to have you with us.
Yeah. Got a question.
Fox News, the settled. Is a settlement a mission of guilt?
Great question, Ken. So the question is
no, it's not.
Right?
No, it's not. So when you keep going around telling Fox, I'm not Fox or CNN, nobody. But legally, you can't go around telling them they're lying because it's not a mission of lie.
Well,
so basically, you guys could possibly get sued also by telling me lied. That's the legal system.
And Ken, appreciate the observation. So my response to your very good question here is, we know what we know, which is that there has been a payment, there will be a payment, of nearly $800 million by an entity that was sued for defamation. They settled that lawsuit, and they're paying money now to avoid the trial and avoid what would have happened this past week. We'll take a look at what specifically the settlement says. It does not contemplate, we believe, a statement of admission of guilt. You're absolutely right about that. But this is the kind of thing that in the public domain, you can, and I and others can look at that and say, under these circumstances, this entity, which was sued for this very purpose, has paid to settle the claims against them for defamation. And I would offer that that speaks volumes about what Fox News is in fact acknowledging in the public domain about what it has done. But appreciate the comment. Appreciate the call, Ken. As we go into our final break here, stay with us here on Morning Cannolis. We are back for this, our final segment of Morning Cannolis on this morning, April 22nd, 2023. Delighted to have some wonderfully engaged and thoughtful callers on all sides of political aisle calling in this morning. Appreciate those comments and questions, as always, here on our broadcast. And we've got one more in our final segment here. Bill, calling in from Oconomowoc. Bill, your thought or question.
Great show. I want to touch on three topics quickly.
Great.
Clarence Thomas, Ron Johnson, and Jim Jordan, all of them have possibly committed crimes. The Chief Justice, if he isn't the Chief Justice, I don't know who is. That's his responsibility to take care of this matter. If he refuses to do so, he does. On Jim Jordan, there's a subpoena that's been issued. He hasn't answered it. And now he wants to answer subpoena. He wants to issue subpoenas. He has no integrity. I think his matter needs to be handled immediately with a warrant. I mean, if you issue a subpoena and you refuse to go, the next step is a warrant. And then last but not least, Ron Johnson, we know at least the records indicate he was involved in illegal electoral votes. He needs to be brought to court. If we don't, our democracy is over. Thank you very much.
Good. Bill, thanks for those comments. Lots to unpack there as well. Always appreciate the perspectives. Let me just pluck up one of those, and that is this issue generally about the imposition of responsibility for responding to subpoenas in all directions. I've said this in the past. We know that we have had some recent successful prosecutions of people who do not, in fact, comply with subpoenas, whether those are congressional subpoenas, certainly court subpoenas as well. Right now, you know well that Jim Jordan is also in a fight with Alvin Bragg, and they're going back and forth about subpoenas issued in both directions, actually just in one direction. Jim Jordan asking for the testimony of a former prosecutor out of Alvin Bragg's office. Bragg's office, the one that has brought these criminal charges under New York state law against the former president. And a judge recently required that the subpoena there be enforced. And again, an awful lot of people out there wondering whether or not there really is jurisdiction for a sitting member of Congress to investigate, to oversee, to take a look at what a state prosecutor is doing. Alvin Bragg had previously pushed back on that a lot. He has recently decided not to pursue an appeal of that, probably for all sorts of strategic reasons there. But the comment that you made just about generally the importance of the rule of law being the subject of discussion and resolution by judges cannot be overstated. Beyond that, the issue about the electoral vote and the electoral college, those matters continue to be the source of investigations, anticipating probably that sometime soon, Fannie Willis in Georgia in early May perhaps will ask a grand jury there in Fulton County to return an indictment with respect to violations of the Georgia election law. We also know, of course, that the U.S. Department of Justice is continuing to look at all matters related to that particular event, January 6th, and attempts to overthrow the government at that time. So lots of good thoughts there, Bill, and lots of good things to unpack as we continue to enforce and to support the rule of law generally in America in all those different venues. Appreciate very much the call and the comment. In our last few moments here, I want to comment also upon another rule of law matter that has been out there this past week, and that has to do with the arrest way back in early April, early part of this month, of this first-class airman. His name is Jack Teixeira, for engaging in the distribution of the leaking of dozens of highly classified documents containing an array of our national security secrets, including both matters related to the war in Ukraine and also our relationship with Russia. A couple of things happened this past week in connection with that. We know already that this young man, this 21-year-old, arrested for engaging in that. We recall well, based upon the information provided previously, that he was online with this group called the Thug Shakers Central, a group of chat members, about 50 people, accessed through this Discord process, this online process. He began posting their sensitive information way back in October of last year. Members of the group have pretty much confirmed that, as have other media outlets. A job as an information security specialist, a technology specialist in Massachusetts with the Air Force, gives him top secret access to these materials. If these allegations are true, plainly a violation of what's called the Espionage Act, very important issue, very important prosecution underway by virtue of a complaint issued by the U.S. attorney in Massachusetts. And so this young man, Jack Teixeira, has appeared in the federal court in Massachusetts. Initially, he was scheduled this past Wednesday to come back in for a detention hearing to determine whether or not he should be released on any conditions of release. Typically, when that happens in our federal and state courts, what that means is that the presiding judge is obliged to take a look at whether or not the particular defendant poses a risk of flight, whether that person will come back for future proceedings, and second, whether that person also poses some threat to the security or safety of our community. Risk to the community, risk of flight. Those are the two things that happen. Well, this past Wednesday, although Mr. Teixeira was back in court, that detention hearing did not, in fact, happen because both the prosecution and the defense requested some additional time from the presiding magistrate judge, who said, yes, I'll give you that time. So we'll come back in a couple of weeks to determine whether or not there's a basis upon which to release Mr. Teixeira. Highly unlikely that the federal judge will do that, but that proceeding is still underway. Meanwhile, he is in federal custody, still detained by virtue of this criminal complaint issued by the U.S. attorney alleging these violations, alleging that these postings were in violation of the Espionage Act, compromising our national security. We don't know a whole lot more about exactly the extent to which compromises were made, but we also know from just this past week that although he's accused of leaking these classified documents to a small group of gamers, this sensitive information being out there, there's a whole lot more information now from newly discovered information posted on a larger chat group that includes details about Russian and Ukrainian casualties, activities of Moscow's spy agencies, and updates on aid being provided to Ukraine. Again, the media coming forth looking further into these postings made by Teixeira even before recent times. The user claimed at the time to be posting this information from the National Security Agency, the CIA, and other intelligence agencies, all indicating that there's a huge amount of information out there still to be presented, likely at a detention hearing coming up sometime soon as this very serious matter goes forward in the federal courts. We'll be talking more about that, not only in the future weeks, but down the road. We're going to be talking next time as well about an issue we just began to touch on, which is guns in America coming out of Tennessee, these other places around America. Come back for those future discussions here on Morning Cannolis. Thanking you once again for your time this morning. Appreciate so much the callers. Do that again in future shows. Be back with me again in those future presentations, those broadcasts here of Civic Media. Have a great week, everybody.